The Ice Maiden by Hans Christian Andersen, narrated by Alex Lehman. Let us visit Switzerland. Let us take a look at that magnificent land of mountains where the forests creep up the sides of the steep rocky walls. Let us climb to the dazzling snowfields above and descend again to the green valleys below, where the rivers and streams rush along as if afraid they'll be too late to reach the ocean and disappear. The burning rays of the sun shine in the deep dales and also on the heavy masses of snow above, so that the ice blocks, which have been piling for years, melt and turn to thundering avalanches or heaped-up glaciers. Two such glaciers lie in the broad ravines under the Schreckhorn and the Wetterhorn, near the little mountain town of Grindelwald. They are strange to look at, and for that reason, in summertime, many travelers come here from all parts of the world. They cross the lofty, snow-capped hills, and they come through the deep valleys. Then they have to climb for several hours, and as they ascend, the valleys seem to become deeper and deeper until they look as if they're being viewed from a balloon. Often the clouds hang around the towering peaks like thick curtains of smoke, while down in the valley, dotted with brown wooden houses, a ray of the sun may be shining brightly, throwing into sharp relief a brilliant patch of green until it seems transparent. The water foams and roars and rushes along below, but up above, the water murmurs and tinkles. It looks as if silver ribbons were streaming down over the rocks. On both sides of the ascending road are wooden houses. Each house has its little potato garden, and this is a real necessity, for within those doors are many hungry mouths. There are many children, and children are often wasteful with food. From all the cottages they swarm out and besiege travelers, whether these be on foot or in carriages. All the children are little merchants. They offer for sale charming toy wooden houses, replicas of those that are built here in the mountains. Some 20 years ago, there often stood here, but always somewhat apart from the other children, a little boy who was also eager to do some business. He would stand there with an earnest, grave expression, holding his chip box tightly with both hands, as if afraid of losing it. But it was this seriousness, and the fact that he was so small, that caused him to be noticed and called forward, so that he often sold more than all the others. He didn't exactly know why himself. His grandfather lived high up on the mountain, where he carved out the neat, pretty little houses. In a room up there he had an old chest full of all sorts of carved things, nutcrackers, knives, forks, boxes with cleverly carved scrollwork and leaping chamois, everything that would please a child's eye. But little Rudy, as he was called, gazed with greater interest and longing at the old gun that hung under the beams of the roof. "He shall have it some day," his grandfather had said, "but not until he's big and strong enough to use it." Small as the boy was, he took care of the goats. If knowing how to climb along with the goats meant that he was a good goatherd, then Rudy certainly was an excellent goatherd. He could even go higher than the goats, for he loved to search for birds' nests high up in the tops of the trees. He was bold and daring. No one ever saw him smile, except when he stood near the roaring waterfall or heard the rolling of an avalanche. He never played with the other children. In fact, he never went near them, except when his grandfather sent him down to sell the things he had carved. And Rudy didn't care much for that. He would much rather climb about in the mountains or sit home with his grandfather and hear him tell stories of ancient times and of the people at nearby Meringen, where he was born. This race, he had said, had not always lived there. They were wanderers from other lands. They had come from the far north, where their people still lived, and were called Swedes. This was a good deal for Rudy to learn, but he learned still more from other teachers, the animals that lived in the house. There was a big dog, Iola, which had belonged to Rudy's father, and there was a tomcat. Rudy had much to thank the tomcat for. The cat had taught him how to climb. "Come out on the roof with me," the cat had said one day, very distinctly and intelligibly, too, for to a little child who can hardly speak, the language of hens and ducks, cats and dogs, is almost as easily understood as that of fathers and mothers. "But you must be very young indeed, then. Those are the days when Grandpa's stick neighs and turns into a horse with head, legs, and tail." Some children keep these thoughts longer than others, and people say that these are exceedingly backward and remain children too long. But people say so much. "Come out on the roof with me, little Rudy," was one of the first things the cat said, and Rudy could understand him. It's all imagination to think you'll fall. You won't fall unless you're afraid. Come on. Put one of your paws here and another there, and then feel your way up with your forepaws. Use your eyes and be very active in your limbs. If there's a hole, jump over it the way I do. And that's what little Rudy did. Very often he sat on the sloping roof of the house with the cat, and often in the tops of the trees, and even high up among the towering rocks where the cat never went. Higher, higher, the trees and bushes said. Can't you see how we climb, how high we go, and how tightly we hold on, even on the narrowest ledge of rock? And often Rudy reached the top of the hill even before the sun. There he took his morning draught of fresh, strengthening mountain air, that drink which only our Lord can prepare, and which human beings call the early fragrance from the mountain herbs and the wild thyme and mint in the valley. Everything that is heavy in the air is absorbed by the overhanging clouds and carried by the winds over the pine woods, while the essence of fragrance becomes light and fresh air. And this was Rudy's morning draught. Sunbeams, daughters of the sun who bring his blessings with them, kissed his cheeks. Dizziness stood nearby watching, but dared not approach him. The swallows from his grandfather's house below, there were at least 7 nests, flew up toward him, and the goats singing, "We and you and you and we." They brought greetings from his home, even from the 2 hens who were the only birds in the house. However, Rudy had never been very intimate with them. Young as he was, he had traveled, and quite a good deal for such a little fellow. He was born in Canton Valais, and brought from there over the hills. He had recently traveled on foot to the nearby Staubach, that seems to flutter like a silver veil before the snow-clad, glittering white Jungfrau. And he had been to the great glaciers near Grindelwald, but there was a sad story connected with that trip. His mother had met her death there, and it was there, as his grandfather used to say, that little Rudy had lost all his childish happiness. When he was less than 1 year old, he laughed more than he cried, as his mother had written. But from the time he fell into the crevasse, his whole nature had changed. His grandfather didn't talk about this very much, but it was known all over the mountain. Rudy's father had been a coach driver, and the big dog that now shared the boy's home had always gone with him on his journeys over the Simplon down to Lake Geneva. Rudy's relatives on his father's side lived in the Rhone Valley in Canton Valais, where his uncle was a celebrated chamois hunter and a famous alpine guide. Rudy was only 1 year old when he lost his father, and his mother decided to return with the child to her own family in the Berner Oberland. Her father lived a few hours' journey from Grindelwald. He was a woodcarver, and his trade enabled him to live comfortably. With her infant in her arms, she set out toward home in June, accompanied by 2 chamois hunters, over the Gemmi toward Grindelwald. They had made the greater part of the journey, had climbed the highest ridges to the snowfields, and could already see her native valley with the familiar scattered cottages. They now had only to cross the upper part of one great glacier. The newly fallen snow concealed a crevasse, not deep enough to reach the abyss below where the water rushed along, but deeper than a man's height. As she was carrying her child, the young woman suddenly slipped, sank down, and instantly disappeared. Not a shriek or groan was heard, only the wailing of a little child. It was over 1 hour before her 2 companions could obtain ropes and poles from the nearest house to pull her out, and after tremendous labor, they brought from the crevasse what they thought were 2 dead bodies. Every means of restoring life was tried, and at last they managed to save the child, but not the mother. Thus the old grandfather received in his house not a daughter, but a daughter's son, the little one who laughed more than he cried. But a change seemed to have come over him since his terrible experience in the glacier crevasse, that cold, strange ice world where the Swiss peasant believes the souls of the damned are imprisoned till doomsday. The glacier lies like a rushing stream, frozen and pressed into blocks of green crystal, one huge mass of ice balanced on another. The swelling stream of ice and snow tears along in the depths beneath, while within it yawn deep hollows, immense crevasses. It is a wondrous palace of crystal, and in it dwells the Ice Maiden, queen of the glaciers. She, the slayer, the crusher, is half the mighty ruler of the rivers, half a child of the air. Thus it is that she can soar to the loftiest haunts of the chamois, to the towering summits of the snow-covered hills, where the boldest mountaineer has to cut footrests for himself in the ice. She sails on a light pine twig over the foaming river below, and leaps lightly from one rock to another, with her long snow-white hair fluttering about her, and her green-blue robe.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.